home of Najeeb and Libby Halaby. The subject this morning is Najeeb Halaby, who was head of the FAA during the Johnson administration. He was president of Pan American Airways before that. But we're going to talk about his reflections and reminiscences of his experience with President Johnson. Why don't you start out by telling about where you, how you got to see, what was the first time you met President Johnson and you came out of the Kennedy group? What do you remember about all that?
I was a Kennedy man in the Johnson era, and I was rather proud of that because I took seriously the best and brightest image that was cast upon me, and I guess that was part of the early interest in my appointment by LBJ, and he, in a sense, I was an unlikely appointee. But the reason I was the appointee for that job is I had been working for Lawrence Rockefeller, and my job was out of the Rockefeller brothers' office in Manhattan, and I naturally had a number of friends in the flying business and had been a naval aviator the prior administration considered me an ample candidate because I was out of the Rockefeller brothers' firm and I was considered fairly business-oriented, partly because of being a graduate of the Yale Law School, and partly because I dressed well and occasionally polished my shoes and had a Texas background, very little recollection of those early days in Texas, but I was born there in 1915, and the reason my mother was down there was that she was one of those marvelous women who appreciated the soil of Texas, the earthiness of it, and she was, like most women, like Lady Bird and a couple of others we've been talking about, she was outspoken and straight from the shoulder, and I guess you'd consider her a fairly tough mother, although she was spoiled me to death, and she supported me financially for all through private schools and Stanford University and so on and so forth. She supported me by his buying rare objets d'art, including the usual rugs, and so I was thought to be a rug dealer of of some kind, well-educated rug dealer, and the reason I was sort of number one or two or three on LBJ's list was that the ATA, the Air Transport Association, and quite a few men around town who knew I had been considered by the what was then the Landis, James Landis was a civil aviation man for Bobby and old man Kennedy and so on, and had done a study for for the aviation industry, so to speak. And I mean, I was sort of the character who did some research on how the airspace was divided up. I remember having some young man or woman do a study of how much airspace there really was and how much congregation there would be in the airspace. So we turned out to 545 million square miles or cubic miles of airspace there was. And that seemed adequate, and so we proceeded from there. And that study led to some recognition, I guess, you might say, or notice that I had done some work on the basic materials of the airspace. I guess you could say that enough of that, Halaby, that qualified you for the Secretary of Commerce in the in the
Kennedy administration?
No, it was the previous administration. Yes. Was so I was considered to be a pretty good candidate for FAA. It was then called the Civil Aeronautics Administration, and until the good old governor, a staunch Republican, heard that I was being considered a Democrat in the Eisenhower administration, and it was a fact that was being one of the names being considered, and that vaulted me to number one on their checklist. And there was a man from Eastman Kodak who was a good friend of mine, who was head of the civil aviation lobby, so to speak. And so that qualified me, I guess, to the Eisenhower administration, and was seriously considered for the FAA position by them until they dropped me because I was a Democrat. And in a sense, that gave me another little boost with the Kennedy crowd, and certainly didn't hurt. I, having been a lawyer practicing in a large law firm in Los Angeles, O'Melveny and Myers, was not a bad qualification for consideration. I won't say that that had much to do with Lyndon, but I believe he would have heard of from anyone like the president of American Airlines, Smith, and that, of course, that was a source for body like me to be considered. And as far as I know, T.R. Smith was a key man, and even it carried over into it was T.R., wasn't
C.R.,
it?
C.R., right.
C.R.
He was a good friend, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was saying a lot of him.
He was a wonderful man, and he was that LBJ disciple who had bridged the gap between cowboy and public administrator. At least he appeared to have done so. And from then on, as a candidate, I received a lot of knocks and help from people like C.R. So that was a part of the political background. And I think Ralph Dungan, who was is the recruiter for rather obscure jobs, technical jobs, such as the FAA, and I worked, didn't work at the campaign to be administrator, because at that point you didn't run for FAA administrator, you let it run after you, and probably just as well. because soon after I was thought to be fit for this job, the Kennedy, the Johnson crowd went after me because it was thought that I would, as a Rockefeller, I would be favorable to Eastern Airlines, in which the Rockefeller family owned about 30% of the stock.
Do you remember when you first met LBJ?
Yes, I met him in at some Wright Brothers dinner at they celebrate each year on the the Wright Brothers' birthday.
Was he vice president then, or was he president?
The president, then LBJ, was vice president.
Vice president.
But he was engaged in, sort of, as he always was, sort of campaigning. And in a way, he was thought to be selecting people for the not the Kennedy administration, but the Johnson administration. And
didn't you say that you, as head of FAA, had organized a kind of a meeting of all the key people in the airlines and the whole business, and got them together at a point, and Johnson, as vice president, was there and saw you operating with this, trying to get some policy paper out of it, and was impressed? I think in that book you talk about after that meeting that Johnson had always been, rather receptive to you.
Well, that was based upon Continental Airlines head Bob Six, and he thought that LBJ hung the moon and was considered by LBJ to be the most cowboyish of the lot. And the funny thing is that if instead of I had opted for a merger with TWA, which raised hell of a problem because it was right in the face of American Airlines, and it was the old energy of the antitrust division likely to oppose anything. But I felt that it would be likely to get approved because both of these airlines, Pan Am and TWA, were faltering. So I developed the concept of faltering airline instead of failing airline. And they both failed later, but can't say I was responsible for that.
Jeep, how did you get along with Johnson?
I thought he was tacky and a cowboy and barely educated, and so I had a limited concept of him from the very beginning, from the day that Bob and Bobby, from the day that they had that famous discussion in Washington over whether they would nominate him for vice president. So I was sort of a Kennedy man from the beginning, and I lived in Georgetown and a lot of odd places like that, and they were wanting the best and the brightest, they alleged, to be in their administration, and I guess I had the belief that I would be the best and brightest for the FAA, but I didn't campaign for it. I simply let things develop, and it turned out that I was much more part of the Eisenhower gang because I had worked for Nelson Rockefeller and Lawrence Rockefeller and those enlightened Republicans who came to have important positions in the Eisenhower. In fact, Eisenhower led us to believe that he would probably want to encourage Nelson Rockefeller to come into the latter days of his administration. And I thought that would be great fun because I knew the family fairly well, and I had done a little work for them. Any case, further answer to your question, I was sort of angry with Nelson for not following through on a suggestion that he made that I be the follow-up man on the Harding Commission, which is then the art. It was such as the present situation of the airlines. Eastern was in the toughest shape. American was in the best shape. United was in the best shape. And I was working for Lawrence Rockefeller, who was considered the venture capitalist of the airline business. He had purchased the largest position in and Eastern Airlines. And he was a source of a lot of support for me to be FAA administrator, even though I didn't think it was becoming of me to be a Democrat in a Republican administration, because I took seriously being a Democrat from everyone except my mother, who was an arch Republican.
The Rockefellers had considerable influence on President Johnson throughout his administration. Did you keep up your association with the Rockefellers during the Johnson years?
And when you said, if you keep up with, I wasn't very close. It's true, he asked me to go over to Eastern Airlines and take a look at it with a possible reason or motivation being that he would consider me as a potential FAA man, and that he would therefore be helpful in procuring the job for me, which I didn't encourage him at all. I'd been rejected by the head of the right wing of the Republican Party.
Do you think?
And when I say right wing of the Republican Party, Luther Hodges was the secretary of
Commerce,
and he didn't think a lot of me. And although he was a quote liberal conservative Republican, he had some very close friends who were involved in Eastern Airlines, and they thought ill of me.
Do you think that Johnson was suspicious of you because you were a Kennedy man? Do you think that had anything to do with his regard for you at all?
Yes, I did. I think the differences in our personalities were more important in that difference. And the array of airline chiefs, for example, at that point in the life of the airline industry, the key players were United American, and the most active, interestingly enough, was American and Eastern. So the key players were the big four of the airline industry, and I don't think I stood very well with them. In fact, I wanted to avoid any entanglement of those lobbyists and special players. I was up to that point was a kind of a reformer of the airline industry. I wasn't a player at all, in that I didn't have a lobby of my own, constituency of my own.
How often on a would you say that during that period you had occasion to meet with the president? Was it frequently or rarely?
When you say that period, you're thinking about the Truman administration.
The Johnson administration.
Johnson. I sort of thought about it as a carryover of the Kennedy administration. I really hated the idea of having to go to work each morning with LBJ instead of Eisenhower or JFK. I didn't hate it in the sense of it just turned me off, but it was no fun anymore. President Truman had given me
Kennedy.
Yes, that's correct. President Kennedy had given me a carte blanche, and he really relied on me, and I was his choice, so to speak. And he believed in delegating authority and get that out of the White House sort of attitude, and he was right. But soon it became clear to me that LBJ was going to, as a result of his comrades from Texas, partially or largely as a result of his comrades from Texas, he was going to look over each decision that I made, and it was not a fully delegated authority. So I felt that it was not that he was a Democrat or that he was from the eastern part of the United States rather than the western part. It was more a difference in personalities and how we had approached things. I wanted to analyze the hell out of everything, and he wanted to charge ahead. I think that's fair statement. It later turned out that he had a difficult job once I had been disposed of, that he had a difficult job of disentangling himself from the C.R. Smiths and the Eddie Rickenbackers and the old guard in the aviation industry, and also he's sort of liked the way I approach things because there was no doubt that I'd be a good Democrat in office and might even be considered for the FBI or something like that.
Well, you weren't disposed of, though. You resigned. You went through a great process of trying to get out, didn't you?
Well, yes, I was hungry to be out because I had the pressure of financing and friendliness. It wasn't fun. I was by appointment of Kennedy, I was in the White House mess. So I was considered a lucky administrator. And that enabled me to have lunch anytime I wanted to over at the White House at the mess, which was actually a kitchen with several Filipino stewards.
Did you maintain that through the Johnson administration, or did they take that away from you?
I maintained it during the Johnson administration, but they didn't take it away from me. It became a considerably less importance as to what access there was to the president through it. In fact, Lyndon didn't very often use it as a staff meeting or over lunch.
Who on the Johnson staff did you have most contact with? Was it Joe Califano or?
In the beginning, Jack Valenti, because largely because she resembled my mother, Mrs. Albert Thomas, the congressman from
Houston,
was the head of the aviation lobby because he had been chairman of the, I shouldn't say the head of the lobby, he was the chairman of the Appropriations Committee, so he was practically the everything. And Jack was kind of a slick trick guy appeared to have LBJ's complete confidence, and he was certainly a congenial and accessible guy to me, and of all the personalities in the White House, I found him the most accessible and easy to deal with. I might say that I also had a pretty good relationship with Walter Jenkins on matters such as not as not matters such as his forays into the bowels of the men's room, but he was a guy who was hard-headed and seemed to me to be worth cultivating, and I did so. Occasionally, Bobby popped up, and